The outgoing governor had his eye on issues both local and national, both involving a shift of power, one in the U.S. Senate, the other in the State House. Senior correspondent David Cruz reports.
Governor, is there a takeaway from Alabama? Is there a takeaway for the nation on what happened there yesterday?
Yeah. A guy who didn't deserve to be elected didn't get elected. I mean, you know, I have
broader context.
No, the president's involvement,
et cetera.
No, I think you're missing the point if you talk about a broader context. I don't think this had anything to do with Donald Trump. I don't think it had anything to do with anybody other than Roy Moore. Roy Moore was unfit to be in the United States Senate. Now he won't be. And the people of Alabama made that determination. And I always had confidence in the fact that they would. And so, you know, to me, I think it's just an affirmation of the fact that our democracy works.
But I mean, if the president weighed in, doesn't that make it a broader question?
No, I don't think it does. I think races, you've heard me say this a lot of times before, David, I think races are always about the candidates. I think endorsements are relatively useless for the most part. And I think that, you know, in the end, people looked at Roy Moore and his record, not only on the allegations that were made, but a lot of other disturbing parts of his record and things that he has said that, to me, just don't belong in public life in our country. So, you know, the people of Alabama made the call, and I watched the returns on Tuesday night and thought, yeah, they got it right.
That letter you got from Phil Murphy seemed to have struck a nerve, ticked you off a little bit.
It did not. The characterization of my response, David, I've been ticked off plenty at you in 8 years, and you never have to, like, read into whether I'm ticked off or not. No, listen, my response to the governor-elect was based upon the unfortunate, ignorant information that he got from his staff. And that's why I repeated in the letter a number of times, like, he needs to hear this stuff directly, because he's got a very inexperienced staff, and people who have not been very involved in the budgeting process at all. The only person that I've seen involved in this process who really understands the budgeting is Mayor McCormick. But other than that, there's nobody who understands budgeting in the least. The thing I was concerned about was that I've kept everything that has been discussed between me and the governor-elect confidential. And it disturbs me when a letter that he sends to me privately, especially a little handwritten note at the bottom, everything's very personal. You know, that should remain between he and I. And when we were crafting a reply to the letter, because there was a lot of detail that I wanted to give him. So I asked the state treasurer to draft a reply for me, and then I would edit it with my own thoughts in it. And then I find out on Sunday that that's in the hands of the press. And it shocked me that that happened, because he has this very elaborate non-disclosure agreement procedure that's unprecedented to do. And I thought that this non-disclosure agreement stuff would actually cause this stuff not to happen. So that's why I made the suggestion in the beginning of the letter that maybe he needs to review his NDA procedure so this kind of stuff wouldn't happen again in the future. Because I think it's really important for governors to be able to have confidential conversation with each other about issues and problems so that everybody can be completely candid. And
was it an experience or just were they just being cheeky by leaking the letter?
I don't know, because I don't know who leaked it. I mean, you know, listen, I think it's fairly obvious that previous administrations, some have been known for leaking more than others. And you and I have discussed many times that our administration has not been a great leaking administration. We like to keep things private and quiet and operate government that way. Governor Corzine's, I think, was very much the same way. Not a lot of leaking of the Corzine administration. Now, you go back to the Cody administration, that was a leak fest. So I hope that it's not that Mr. Camerano is now coming back into government and he's now leading the charge towards, you know, governing by leaking. I trust it wasn't him, given that he's been given such an important position, but it raises concerns, and I think it should raise concerns for the governor-elect. We had the state treasurer sitting there. We gave them not only current budget expenditures, but budget projections and revenue projections, and we opened up the books to them, and we're continuing to do that. But I think the governor-elect, and that's what I suggest in my letter, needs to sit and listen to this personally, because he is somewhat, I suppose, given his background, somewhat of a financial expert. So I think he would understand this stuff much more clearly than some of the very, you know, young and inexperienced people that he sent to listen to the briefings.
What do you think of his choices so far? Moyo today for Treasury and yesterday Graywall.
Well, I put out a statement on Prosecutor Graywall. I think it's a fabulous choice. I worked really hard, as you know. For 3 years, I fought to put Grubier in as the Bergen County prosecutor. Fought the Democrats in Bergen County, like Loretta Weinberg and Paul Sarlo, who did not want him to be the prosecutor. Now, all of a sudden, they're a champion of him. I think it's great that the governor-elect has picked a Christie person to be the attorney general. So I commend them for it. I think it's a great thing. I think Grabeer will do a great job. I think he's done a very good job in Bergen County, and I think he'll grow into this job. He's got great background and experience as an assistant U.S. attorney and now as a county prosecutor, and I'm very optimistic about how he'll do. All right. Thank you, guys. Thanks for coming out today.